Good morning. Morning, everyone. And well, I was going to say it's nice to be here, but I was here anyway. I'm sitting on my sofa. It's nice that you're here. I think that makes more sense, doesn't it? We're coming to worship the Lord together. It's a little bit crazy outside, but there's nothing crazy going on in here. We're going to worship the Lord and tell him how we feel about him and lift our minds and our hearts above what's going on around us. We don't have to worry about tomorrow because we're not living there. And yesterday's gone. We're living today. And the Lord tells us to sing a new song every day. So that's what we're going to do today. And in the spirit of a new song, we have a new song for you now. Holy Spirit, Living Breath of God. Let's come to the Lord in prayer, shall we? Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the work of the Holy Spirit. He speaks to us and tells us the things that we need to hear, brings to our remembrance the things of Scripture, and he shows us as well what Jesus is like and how we should be like him. We thank you, Lord, for your promptings toward life and away from a path of death. Thank you, Lord, that you lead us into truth and honesty. Thank you, Lord, that you lead us into righteousness. Lord, we pray for those things in us. We pray, Lord, that we can see those things more in the world today. We're disturbed when we are told lies. We're disturbed when we know that other people are being told lies as well. And Lord, this is just the indication of a fallen world. But Lord, we pray that you would bring fallen man back to you. Lord, we pray that righteousness shall reign. We pray that there should be honesty. We pray, Lord, that there should be virtue and kindness in a world that's all about signaling virtue and signaling kindness. We pray that there should be genuine goodness in our fellow man. And we pray, Lord, that it'll start with us. Make us kind people and good people, we pray. Lord, we ask that you would help us in our meeting today to hear what you have to say to us. And we pray, Lord, that you would speak to our hearts as well as our minds. We pray, Lord, that you would fit us for your service. And Lord, encourage us in our way as we seek to follow you. There's lots of different things that would work against your plans in the world today. But Lord, we pray that you'd help us to be faithful. And Lord, send your spirit upon us, we pray, during this time together, that we might hear you, that we might be moved toward you. We ask, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to have our first reading, which is from the first book of Samuel in the Old Testament, 1 Samuel chapter 1 and verse 1 to 18. 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 1 to 18. It's not going to help you, but in the Church Bible, that's page 271, unless you've stolen one from church. Well, I hope you haven't done that, but here we are. 1 Samuel chapter 1 from verse 1. And after this, we're going to have a video. And I think this was actually delivered, a little talk that Matt Gamston was delivering to children in relation to his work with the GBM, I think. Straight after that, we're going to have another song, Come O Fount of Every Blessing. But here's our reading, 1 Samuel 1. There was a certain man from Ramathaim, a Zophite from the hill country of Ephraim, whose name was Elkanah, son of Jeroham, the son of Elihu, the son of Tohu, the son of Zoph, an Ephraimite. Wow. Okay. He had two wives. One was called Hannah and the other Peninnah. Peninnah had children, but Hannah had none. Year after year, this man went up from his town to worship and sacrifice to the Lord Almighty at Shiloh, where Hophni and Phinehas, the two sons of Eli, were priests of the Lord. Whenever the day came for Elkanah to sacrifice, he would give portions of the meat to his wife Peninnah and to all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah he gave a double portion because he loved her, and the Lord had closed her womb. Because the Lord had closed Hannah's womb, her rival kept provoking her in order to irritate her. This went on year after year. Whenever Hannah went up to the house of the Lord, her rival provoked her till she wept and would not eat. Her son Elkanah would say to her, "Hannah, why are you weeping? Why don't you eat? Why are you downhearted? Don't I mean to you more than 10 sons?" Once when they had finished eating and drinking in Shiloh, Hannah stood up. Now Eli the priest was sitting on his chair by the doorpost of the Lord's house. In her deep anguish, Hannah prayed to the Lord, weeping bitterly, and she made a vow, saying, "Lord Almighty, if you'll only look on your servant's misery and remember me, and not forget your servant, but give her a son, then I will give her give him to the Lord all the days of his life, and no razor will ever be used on his head. As she kept on praying to the Lord, Eli observed her mouth. Hannah was praying in her heart, and her lips were moving, but her voice was not heard. Eli thought she was drunk, and he said to her, "How long are you going to stay drunk? Put away your wine." "Not so, my Lord," Hannah replied. "I'm a woman who is deeply troubled. I've not been drinking wine or beer. I was pouring out my soul to the Lord. Do not take your servant for a wicked woman. I've been praying here out of my great anguish and grief." Eli answered, "Go in peace, and may the God of Israel grant you what you have asked of him." She said, "May your servant find favor in your eyes." Then she went her way and ate something, and her face was no longer downcast. Early the next morning, they arose and worshipped before the Lord. They went back to their home at Ramah. Elkanah made love to his wife Hannah, and the Lord remembered her. So in the course of time, Hannah became pregnant, gave birth to a son. She named him Samuel, saying, "Because I asked the Lord for him." Samuel's maybe one of the greatest prophets of the Old Testament, and this is God's answer of his prayer to her. But we're going to hear from Matt Gamston.
I rejoice when Jesus gets the attention. It's easy to say, isn't it? Yes, Jesus, you must increase, I must decrease. Easy to say that, even easy to want that. But sometimes there's moments when we just see something in our hearts, aren't there? And then we know. Where I used to live in the Philippines, the first place I used to live, had problems with wildlife. A few rats, a lot of mice, and tons of cockroaches. It was crazy. They're everywhere. Okay, no matter how many you kill, there's always like a million more somewhere. But if you wanted to come and see that in my house, if you came in and it was maybe during the day and I took you in, okay, can you see any rats and mice and cockroaches? No. Okay, so there's none here. Great. Everything's fantastic. But wake up like 3 o'clock in the morning to go to the toilet and come out quietly and just flick the light switch. And it's like, there's like 50 different things running in different directions to hide under the fridge or wherever else they go. Sometimes you kind of like turn the light on quickly and then you see it, don't you? And it's sometimes in our lives when suddenly like this light shines and then we see what's in our hearts, moments when we really know whether we're living for Jesus's glory or just our own. Let me suggest two ways when that light may shine in our lives. Firstly, when he uses other people. You see, of course, when people become Christians through preaching, I rejoice as long as it's me who's preaching. And when like a church is really growing and loads of people have been saved and amazing things are happening, I rejoice as long as it's my church. But what about when God uses others? What about others in your church? What about other churches? Could I rejoice? And if I couldn't, what does that show? It shows this. I'm not really in love with the name and reputation of Jesus Christ. I'm just in love with my own name and reputation. I can't rejoice when Jesus is exalted and worshipped and glorified when God uses someone else. And it shows it's about me, isn't it? There's so much jealousy, so much competition, even in our churches, even amongst Christians. And that just shows our names and our reputations are so mixed up in all of this. And yet when there's no credit in it for us and we can still rejoice when Jesus gets praised, that shows, doesn't it? We're in love with the name of Jesus. And then the second way to see when that kind of light shines in, that moment we'll know is when we get forgotten. John says, "He must increase, I must decrease." Remember hearing David Platt saying something like, "Yeah, I know he must increase, but the temptation in my heart is that I'd really like to increase as well. He must increase, I can increase a bit as well." And maybe you know what that feels like. You know, you're stuck in traffic and this ambulance comes and the sirens are going and it kind of everyone else gets out of the way and the ambulance goes straight down the middle. You think, that's right, you know, everyone get out of the way for the ambulance. But if I could just get in behind the ambulance, you know, I could just overtake everybody and just ride in at the back of the ambulance. But if I want people to focus on Jesus, I need to get out of the way, don't I? I want to point people away from me and point them to him. That's just the opposite of the message of our world, isn't it? Every kind of voice, papers, magazines, TV, radio, it's all saying that you live for the attention to be on you. The great dream of everybody today is to be famous. So everybody kind of looks at me. There's two ways to live, really, when it comes to this. You can go through life living for your own kind of praise, everybody to look at me, everybody to think how great I am. Or you can live for the glory of Jesus and you can have real joy now, because that's what we're made for. That's what we're on this planet for, to live for the glory of God, to see how great and amazing God is. And then one day in eternity, if we're Christians, we will have the whole of eternity to just praise and worship King Jesus. And we'll find the greatest joy in praising him.
Oh.
Great, that's good. So we've gone around a bit now, haven't we? I think Matt Gamston's in the Philippines, and I don't know where that was, but it was pretty high up, some of that stuff. And here's the Lord in all of it. Well, we're going to have our next reading now, and we're leaving James for a week and going to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. And I'll read the whole chapter, as it's not all that long. This is where Paul defends his ministry from criticism from people who are not very happy with him. So this is 2 Corinthians 10 from verse 1. By the humility and gentleness of Christ, I appeal to you. I, Paul, who am timid when face to face with you, but bold towards you when away. I beg you that when I come, I may not have to be as bold as I expect to be towards some people who think that we live by the standards of this world. For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ, and we will be ready to punish every act of disobedience once your obedience is complete. You are judging by appearances. If anyone is confident that they belong to Christ, they should consider again that we belong to Christ just as much as they do. So even if I boast somewhat freely about the authority the Lord gave us of building you up rather than tearing you down, I'll not be ashamed of it. I do not want to seem to be trying to frighten you with my letters, for some say his letters are weighty and forceful, but in person he's unimpressive and his speaking amounts to nothing. Such people should realize that what we are in our letters when we are absent, we will be in our actions when we are present. We do not dare to classify or compare ourselves with some who commend themselves. When they measure themselves by themselves and compare themselves with themselves, they're not wise. We, however, will not boast beyond proper limits, but will confine our boasting to the sphere of service God himself has assigned to us, a sphere that also includes you. We're not going too far in our boasting, as would be the case if we had not come to you, for we did get as far as you with the gospel of Christ. Neither do we go beyond our limits of boasting of work done by others. Our hope is that, as your faith continues to grow, our sphere of activity among you will greatly expand, so that we can preach the gospel in the regions beyond you. But we do not want to boast about work already done in someone else's territory. But let the one who boasts boast in the Lord. For it is not the one who commends himself who is approved, but the one whom the Lord commends. Yeah, that's good, isn't it? Okay, let's come to the Lord in prayer. Let's pray. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for the wise words that Paul was given to share with the church in Corinth, and we hear them today and they ring true with us as well. We're hearing about boasting, we're hearing about misrepresentation, we're hearing about how people speak of themselves and of other people, and Lord, we know that we should be careful in what we say. It's one of the Ten Commandments to not bear false witness. So, Lord, we pray that you'd help us to be honest people and, Lord, to look within ourselves and be honest and to see other people and be honest too. Father, we thank you that you lead us through life and you take us on a journey right from the cradle to the grave. Lord, some of us have a longer journey than others, and we're grateful for all the time that we have. Lord, we just want to ask that you would help us not to waste all of it, not to just go through life biding our time, waiting for something to happen. But Lord, we pray that you'd help us to be people who make things happen too, and to listen to you as you're prompting things to be done. Lord, we ask that you'd bless this church, scattered in different houses. Pray, Lord, that you'd bless people who are not of this church. Pray, Lord, that you'd keep us all looking to you. We pray that you would warm our hearts when there is much to chill our thoughts. Lord, we pray that you would suspend, that you would draw to a halt, Lord, this virus. Lord, we know that there's a purpose to it. We know that there is a reason why these things happen. But Lord, we pray that you would remember mercy and that you would not let things go any further than they need to go. We pray, Lord, that these things will draw to a close. And Lord, we pray that you'd give us all a sense of hope and an awareness, Lord, that in your purpose will be fulfilled. And when it's fulfilled in the virus, then the virus will finish. And Lord, we pray that day will draw close to us all. Pray, Lord, that you keep us safe as well. That, Lord, by your mercy, you would keep us healthy. And Lord, for those who are not feeling so good at the moment, we pray, Lord, that their health will be restored to them swiftly. We pray, Lord, that you'd help us not to think that you lie on the other side of the tunnel, but Lord, you're with us through the valley of the shadow, as well as the green pastures and the still waters. Lord, we pray that you'd be with us in all of these times and help us to maintain that expectation and hope in you. We pray, Lord, for countries that are doing very badly. Think of Brazil and perhaps Belgium, Russia, China, and the US. Lord, we just pray that there may be a turning to you in all of these places. Lord, we ask, Lord, that one day we shall look back and we shall see that those nations that have been affected by these terrible things the most have actually seen the most people turn to you. Lord, we pray that you would achieve your purposes. And Lord, we pray too for the coming again of the Lord Jesus. Lord, we know when he comes, then all pain and suffering shall cease. And Lord, our hope is for that day. But Lord, until then, we pray for patience and endurance and courage and faith, which will give us endurance and patience. Lord, we pray then that you would hear our prayers for ourselves and for those who are not so good. We pray, Lord, for those we know that are ill at this time, and not just with the virus, but with other things as well. We, Lord, bring them to you. And we ask, Lord, that they'd get the help that they need. We pray, our God, that you would sustain those who are caregivers. Give them strength, Lord. We know it's so difficult to keep going on and doing these things, but Lord, we pray that you would give courage and endurance to these brave people who are doing so much for the rest of us. We appreciate them. And we ask our God that you would bless them, especially those who love you, Lord, that they should draw strength from you at this time, that you would help them. Lord, be with us then, we pray, and hear our prayers. We come in Jesus' name. Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen. Our next song is half in the book and half of it isn't. It's number 1122. It's one of those songs that... it's really great to sing, but it's just not long enough. So we had another verse, and you might remember that we had another verse in the church, but I didn't go around all your houses and write in all your books what the second verse was. So be patient for verse 2, because we'll be back together again in the chorus. Number 1122. Okay. Now, when you're down with the kids, like I am, you'll be familiar with the expression that was probably used about 20 years ago, keeping it real. Oh, yeah. Keeping it real. Keeping it real, we use that expression to mean not faking it, being your genuine self. And it's what Paul is talking about in 1 Corinthians 10. You know, whether it's a new expression or not, Paul is talking about that same theme, like about 2,000 years ago. And he's writing with great humility, but full awareness of his responsibility to his readers as well. So he's got to keep it real, but he's got to look after the people that he's writing to. So there's three paragraphs in 2 Corinthians chapter 10. And we're going to go through the different paragraphs. The first paragraph, chapter 10, verse 1 to 6, he's talking about spiritual fighting. And so we're thinking about keeping it real in spiritual fighting. Paul claims his authority to write words of correction to the people at Corinth. He wants them to know that he can do that. He says, I appeal to you. I'm writing to you on what basis? Chapter 10, verse 1, by the humility and gentleness of Christ. I'm appealing to you. I'm saying to you, this is how things have got to be, by the humility and gentleness of Christ. Now, it's a strange and a powerful introduction to a paragraph in which he dwells on the subject of fighting. Verses 3 to 5, listen to this. For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. We take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. There he is, warlike. He's going to fight. And so he's appealing to them by the humility and gentleness of Christ. And there's such a powerful lesson for us here. There's a lot of wrong ways to deal with major issues in life. But Paul approaches the Corinthian problems without a safety net, using no emotional PPE at all. Perhaps you've heard of what a Swiss-American psychiatrist named Elizabeth Kubler-Ross wrote in 1969. She described grief and the acceptance of loss, and she identified five stages of grief that people naturally pass through: denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and finally acceptance. So something awful happens, truly awful, and you deny that it's happened, then you're angry that it's happened, then you say, well, you know, if that's happened, then maybe this and maybe that. And then you slip into depression. And then finally, ultimately, you manage acceptance. Well, that's what this lady said in 1969. And through observation, it's been generally agreed of the truth of this. And especially as it's been popularized in The Simpsons, and Homer Simpson went through all of those stages of grief, bang, 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 just as it was described. But it's quite common to gradually adjust to something shocking or costly to you. Now, if the five stages of grief are a common experience shared by many, that's okay. But there are times in which we can face issues with greater strength and confidence with the help of the Lord himself in our lives. It doesn't mean that the five stages of grief aren't there, but we can face those different things with God in our lives as well. And he enables us to have a degree of strength that we otherwise wouldn't have. Now, Zechariah came back to Jerusalem from exile, and he was told by God to rebuild the temple, which was an enormous task that seemed impossible at the time. But God told Zechariah this to encourage him. He said in Zechariah 4, verse 6, "Not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord Almighty." You're going to be able to do this by and with the help of my spirit. So there's this natural sense in which we go through the motions of the mind as we adjust and as we cope with different things. But there's another sense in which we can approach things by the spirit. And I know it's easy to confuse these two things. And we can feel sometimes if we're not very, very happy, well, that must mean that we're spiritually not very good. That's not the case at all. There's the mind and then there's the spirit. And the triumph is when the spirit is enabled to strengthen the mind. Paul was dealing with some major issues in Corinth, and some of which we'd find pretty alarming today. But Paul writes to the Corinthians not to impress them with himself, but with the God who is within them, even as they're dealing with incredible issues that you think, well, how can they even be Christians? And they've got these awful things going on and they're tolerating terrible things. Paul brings them back to their original love of the Lord and how they are believers. And he inspires strength from within rather than just looking to pull yourself up by your bootstraps. He talks in verse 4 of spiritual weapons. The weapons we fight are not with the weapons of this world. The weapons of this world, you might be thinking of not guns and tanks and things like that, but processors that you can put your mind through and that kind of thing. Yeah, we can deal with things and they're helped by that. But actually, when it comes to spiritual matters, they're dealt with spiritually. And of these spiritual weapons in verse 4, he says they have the divine power to demolish strongholds. And here he is identifying the real nature of the enemies, not the argumentative type, not just the proud type or the difficult to get along with type. The heart of the problem is this. In verse 5, these are the problems. We demolish arguments, every pretension that sets itself against the knowledge of God. We take every captive, we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. The real problem is disobedience and those things, those issues within ourselves that set themselves against the knowledge of God. You know God loves me. Bad things happen. And what's the first thing that you might think? Oh, well, I don't know if God loves me. Well, you know, this is things setting themselves up against the knowledge of God. We've got this virus going on. How long is it going to go? Is it ever going to finish? Well, God is my strength in times of trouble. God is my rock. His banner over me is love. Jesus said, build your life upon his teaching. You're building your life upon a rock that isn't moving. This is a life with strength. This is a life with ability. And this is a life that Paul says that he has and he's depending on, even as he's approaching them with their horrendous problems. We need to go forward knowing what the real issues are and not getting blindsided by, fake news. People are scared of the virus and fear blanks out faith and trust in our all-powerful, loving God. People are worried about the future, hoping for an end of all of this. They need to know God with them, not wondering if he'll be with them tomorrow. They need to know that God is with them right now. God is with you right now. If you're a scientist, work with science, but trust God as you do. Whatever vulnerabilities life is throwing at you right now, respond with sense, with wisdom, with care, but always with confidence in God. I've said it before, chapter 10, verse 1. By the humility and gentleness of Christ, I appeal to you. It is by God's grace and his character defining work in me, I'm making my appeal to you. It's not just that I'm someone who talks a lot. It's God within me. All right, so there's Paul talking about fighting and the fight in the first paragraph. In the second paragraph, he addresses the issue of misleading appearances. I've been saying that this is where we're going with this, misleading appearances. We need to be keeping it real, not allowing ourselves to give COVID more power than God, not giving it more power over us than God already has, not letting our fears leap out of control, but bringing our fears back to the master. You know, it's a really strange thing how things can just spring upon you sometimes. And, you know, you wake up in the morning and you read something and all of a sudden your heart sinks and you don't know where to turn. You don't know what you're doing. And you need to bring these things to the Lord. And you need to remember God is in control. Don't fall for a waxworks dummy instead of the real thing. I can't imagine anybody else, maybe it's my weak imagination, anybody going into Madame Tussauds and falling for one of the waxworks dummies of one of these beautiful actresses. No, it's just a waxwork. It's just a representation. Don't fall for an imitation instead of the real thing, which is God who has control over everything. It's quite a thing in the Bible, actually, to beware of what things look like because they can be misleading. I read to you earlier, didn't I, from 1 Samuel, the story of how Eli condemns Hannah as drunk. How long are you going to do this? Put away your wine, he says. He sees her greatly upset in the temple. He thinks she's drunk, but she's profoundly pouring out her heart to the Lord about her childlessness. And that's an enormous whopper, isn't it? When you think about it, here's this lady deep in her devotions, throwing caution to the wind, just pouring it out before the Lord. And Eli leaps to such a wrong conclusion. She's drunk. Well, we've got to beware, haven't we, leaping to wrong conclusions. David didn't really look all that much, did he, when he was a boy facing Goliath? But he trusted God, and God came through for him. Might not feel as though you're all that much, but God will come through for you. Colossians 2, 21 to 23 says this, do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. These rules, which have to do with things that are all destined to perish with use, are based on merely human commands and teachings. Such regulations indeed have an appearance of wisdom with their self-imposed worship, their false humility, and their harsh treatment of the body, but they lack any value in restraining sensual indulgence. So there's your Old Testament commands. And there is the explanation of why so many rules-based religions or law-based religions will not actually make any difference to you, because they don't actually affect your heart. All they do is say, do this with your body, think this way with your head. They don't actually involve your heart and in relation with the Lord at all. So they have an appearance of good when they're not all that good. So it seems as though things weren't looking too good for Paul at the time of his writing to the Galatians, and we can understand that. He's writing this epistle from Ephesus, 354 miles away, and the people there in Corinth, they're going to be wondering if they'll ever see him again, and his teaching is now so distant, they've begun to drift into poor behavior and strange doctrine, and they're thinking, well, you know, there he was and he saw what was going on, but we're not seeing him now, and you know, we've found a better way. You know, we can go on the way that accommodates the way we want to be. And his rebuke to them in verse 7 is this: you are judging by appearances, in that straight to the heart way that the NIV version has, that isn't quite so flowery as the Authorized version. Sometimes in the NIV he says, you are judging by appearances. They were confident that they were good disciples. And Paul was the peculiar one. Apparently, as he says in verse 9, I don't want to seem to be trying to frighten you with my letters. Well, his bark in his letters was thought to be a great deal worse than his bite in person. Oh, well, he seems as though he's going on, but he doesn't really know what he's talking about. Being honest with ourselves is so important. And the Corinthians had drifted a long way from the straightforwardness that Paul had introduced to them. They'd forgotten who he was, what he was like. They had drifted into their own wickedness and felt that that was acceptable to the Lord when it never was going to be. Being honest with yourself is very important. It goes hand in hand with being honest with God. How are you going to be real with God if you can't be honest with yourself? You've got to say to yourself, before you say to God even, this is where I am. This is what things are like. This is what I am as you come to God. You're going to need to bring your issues to the Lord in prayer, not somebody else's. And don't miss out the things that really matter. You bring the things to the Lord that really you genuinely feel you need to bring to the Lord. Be real, be honest. Reading scripture is beneficial when you allow it a place in your heart. James, he wrote about looking in a mirror and walking away without changing whatever needs to be changed. He's looked in it and, okay, I've looked in it, I've seen it, and he didn't do anything about it. So Paul looked small and he didn't really seem to carry much with him. It shouldn't shock us, really, as it was Paul who wrote in his first letter to the Corinthians, the one before this, obviously. God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. Paul had already told them that, but I guess they must have forgotten that because they don't have much time for him. You don't have to look clever. What matters are the weapons of the Lord in your life. You don't have to know ever so much. You need to know the one himself, and he'll teach you more about himself through the scripture. The weapons of the Lord in your life are given to you in Ephesians 6, spiritual armor of Ephesians 6. Paul tells the Ephesians what you need are faith, love, salvation, truth, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. When your confidence is in the Lord, well, you know, it might be quiet. It might be a quiet confidence, but it will become evident that it is in the rock, the banner that's over you, the one who's eternal. As we look at ourselves and see, well, I'm just a moment. Okay, but God is eternal. So this moment is going to trust in the eternal nature of God. And Paul, so confident in these things, leads us to the third chapter, which addresses the issue of boasting. Boasting. Paul is boasting. He says, when he boasts, he's boasting about the people he has reached with the gospel and who have responded to it. That's the issue of his boasting. And he tells his readers that they, the Corinthians, are some of the reasons that he boasts. Now, I wonder if he actually says it in the second book. Well, he introduces 2 Corinthians in chapter 1 to the church of God in Corinth, together with all his holy people throughout Achaia. in the first book to the Corinthians and chapter 1, verse 2, to the church of God in Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus and called to be his holy people. Well, actually, you read those books to the Corinthians, you find out how holy they appear to be. But this is what God has done. He's called them to be holy. And Paul's boasting in the fact that he's spoken to them and they've received the Lord Jesus. Let's see how Paul can think it's okay to boast when boasting often inflates our own view of ourselves. How can Paul boast without just inflating an opinion of himself? Whatever we think of ourselves when we boast, generally it makes other people think less of us. So, you know, that's a good lesson of life to remember, isn't it? Boasting might make you feel good for a short time, but it makes other people aware that you are a boaster, so don't do it. Well, here we are, two things Paul boasts in. Verse 13, we, however, will not boast beyond proper limits, but will confine our boasting to the sphere of service God himself has assigned to us, a sphere that also includes you. This is like the parable that Jesus told of the workers that he gave talents of gold to look after. Talent was a weight measurement, and he gave different people talents of gold, different measures of talents of gold to look after. And when he came back, he expected to see some repayment for the investment that was made. And three different guys given different amounts. Paul is saying, do you know what? It's like I'm the guy that the Lord gave the most of the gold to invest, to look after. It's amazing that he's given me such a wide area, a huge responsibility to look after, to invest for him. And I'm just thrilled that he's given me so much work to do for him. And I hope that's how you feel to some degree yourself, that you're pleased, you're chuffed that the Lord has given you so much to do for him. And if you can't think of anything God has given you to do for him, well, think about your family, think about living, thinking about keep going on, thinking about how maybe you get the chance to speak to other people. Yeah, God's given us all things to do for him. And Paul, really way above us all in the amount that God entrusted to him. Well, he's saying that. That's one thing he's boasting on. Then he quotes Jeremiah in verse 17. And in verse 17, he writes, let the one who boasts boast in the Lord. Okay, so whatever the Lord has given you to do, that's great. Boast about it. Wow, the Lord has given me this. You know, I'm gonna really do my best for him. I'm gonna really pour it on because he's given me this opportunity. But apart from that, boast in the Lord. Boasting can be defined as being excessively proud and self-satisfied talk about one's own achievements. Well, Paul moves right away from his own achievements, and he talks often about what the Lord has done through him, what the Lord has done through him, as shown in the people that he's been speaking and writing to. He glories in God's achievements. And that's what we need to do, glory in God's achievements. And even in the days such as we're living in, God is doing wonderful things in our church. God's doing great things. And it's just so exciting at a members meeting yesterday. The Lord is bringing us on, and it's great to be a part of this. Some people don't boast because they're not proud. Some people don't boast because they have no confidence. Paul has a lot of confidence in verses 5 and 6, but he's not full of himself. Verses 5 and 6, I read to you already. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. And we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. And we'll be ready to punish every act of disobedience once your obedience is complete. You know, he's taking captive every thought to bring it in obedience to, not himself, to Christ. Let's dwell for a few moments on how Paul manages to achieve great confidence and great humility at the same time. We can illustrate this with something completely different. Why is it sometimes we find prayer so hard? Maybe often we find prayer very, very difficult. Why can our faith be so much hard work? We wonder why the joy we had in spiritual things seems so diminished. And we wonder if there's another hitherto unsuspected symptom of COVID. Yeah, okay, COVID, that's the thing that gives you, it takes your sense of taste away, it makes you tired, gives you headaches, gives you a cough, and makes you irreligious. Another symptom of COVID. Well, the root of the problem is easy to grasp why faith can be difficult sometimes. And it isn't COVID. We'll not snap from an instant and in an instant to from no love to the Lord to a deep, sustained spiritual experience. It doesn't happen bang, just like that. The engines of older cars, cars of a certain age, benefit from being warmed up on a cold day before you drive them because they work better with a bit of a warm-up. You notice this in cooking as well. You fry mince and onions and you put them in there and you're making a lovely chili. So it's all browned off and it's all looking good. And then you're told that you've got to add your cans of tomatoes and kidney beans to make your chili. And this bubbling, frying away stuff that's really full of life and everything, you dump all that stuff on it, and what happens? It goes stone cold. And all the bubbling mince instantly stops bubbling when the cold stuff is added. That's what happens. If you have no heart for the Lord, if you're not really feeling that much of the Lord, you need to warm up before you can expect for him to fill you from top to toe. Being honest with yourself, you need to warm to him. So you have to come through the coldness and warm a bit more. So you read a bit, you pray a bit, and it gets you a little bit warmer. So you read a bit more, you pray a bit more, get a bit warmer. You talk about the Lord to other people. You watch your sermons, you watch your things, and it gradually fills you. Paul's confidence in the Lord is in the Lord, not in himself. He knows he's God, and he knows what he's capable of doing himself. On one occasion, he's so taken up with his capacity for wrong that he calls himself the chief of sinners. He knows his capacity for wickedness. He knows what it would be like to be cold, but he attempts to keep the warmth going. We need to be filled up with the Lord, boast in the Lord. And when we do that, we're never going to be boasting of ourselves. So that's the issue, really. Nature abhors a vacuum. If there's nothing there, then it's going to be filled with other stuff. And it takes a little bit of time sometimes to evict some of the other stuff and to welcome the Lord back in. But there's persistence. There's carrying on. There's walking with the Lord, because we're all on a journey, and heaven's gates for some of us might be a long way away. And before we get there, we need to warm up and look to the Lord. I came across this saying online, and I think it'll engender humility or the praise of God. One of those two things, if you hear this, you'll either be humbled a little bit or you'll praise the Lord. Picture everyone saying this to you. We met for a reason. Either you're a blessing or a lesson. Now, you today might be a blessing to people, or you might be a lesson to people. But that's okay. Look to the Lord and interpret things the way that he wants them to be seen. We're going to be singing our last song now. Number 1035, and it's a very short song, actually. Number 1035. blessed be the name of the Lord. He is worthy to be praised and adored. So we lift our holy hands in one accord, saying, blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. He is worthy to be praised the Lord. So we lift our holy hands and we'll adore. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Saying, blessed be the name. Blessed be that name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Well, let's come to the Lord in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for your mercies to us. And Lord, we pray that you would help us to be people who keep it real with you and with ourselves and with other people as well. We thank you, Lord, for the inner strength that you give to us. And Lord, we're sorry that sometimes we run away from it. Sometimes we want to just launch out on our own and we forget about you. We pray, Lord, that you give us strength in you and help us, Lord, to define ourselves in you rather than in our own right. Lord, thank you for everything you've given us. Pray once again, Lord, for those who are in need at this time. And we pray, Lord, that you'd bless those and those who are seeking to help them in their need. We pray, Lord, that you'd minister in our town and all around the world. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, there's various things going on during the week. There's the Ladies' Bible Study.